Evening, ladies and gents. It's Simon Brown here doing this evening's presentation. This evening's webinar really looking at those silent risks, what I call the silent killers in trading, and quite simply they spread, they slippage, they costs. And I think everyone's probably sitting here and saying, well, yeah, duh, we know this, and that's 100%. The reason for this webinar is really to focus our minds down it. I think we've all done a trade or a transaction where things didn't go as well as planned. Everything went well, but we didn't seem to come out with a profit for it. And really what I'm looking to do this evening is just to get us to focus on these three critical areas, because they are very, very important. Alexander Elder talks about the elite trader, and what he refers to is that if there's a move of X percentage, the elite trader is catching about 70%, the average trader 45 or 50%, and the poor trader, the novice trader, maybe 10 or 15 or 20%. And a good part of that problem are these three issues that I've mentioned here, and how we manage that process, and how we make sure that we remove this out of the equation as much as possible. I'm going to go into each of them in detail, and obviously we can't make them disappear, but we need to look at how we can potentially make them less of an issue, and that's that critical component. And that's really this evening's webinar. It's going to be relatively short. I just wanted to get people, as I said, to focus down on it, to get really analytical. If we can save a little bit here, a little bit there in every single trade we do over a trading year, over a trading lifetime, those numbers are going to become quite significant and add up to massive differences in that process. So I want to, first, I suppose, is how bad can they be? I mean, your spread could be 1% or more. Your slippage could be a percentage or more, and your costs could be 1% or more. That takes 3% out of your trade. 3% on the buy side, 3% on the sell side. That's not insignificant. So you grab a 12% move in a stock, or whatever it is you're trading, you grab a 12% move, half of it effectively disappears. Now, those numbers, 1%, 1%, 1%, are going to be different, but that's the key point. We need to manage those down. And in this example, imagine if we could get them each down to, say, 0.3%, then instead of suddenly 3% on each side of the trade, we're looking at a 1% hit on either side. And that's that focus, that attention to detail. And it comes back to, a trading system is not just a chart. It's not just telling you what to buy or what to sell. It's much more than that. It's also saying to you, well, how do we put it together? How do we manage it? What product are we trading? Why are we trading it? And an important point I want to make here is that it's not a case of us fitting ourselves to the market, to our system. We need to design systems that work for us. And this is part of that process. Now, we need to make sure that the system meets our requirements, gives us the quality of life and the level of profits, etc., that we're looking for. We can all be day traders and do 150 trades a day, but does that give us what we're trying to achieve? And that's what's, to my mind, very, very important in that space. So I'm going to delve into each of them in more detail. And your spread, the difference between that buy and that sell price. You've got buyers at 1 rand and sellers at around 10, whatever the case may be. Buyers at 290 rand, sellers at 290 rand 50. The point being is that if you cross the spread, you immediately give it away. And what I mean by that is your portfolio is valued. Your trade is valued what you can sell it for. So let's take an extreme example. We buy something at 2 rand, but the buyers are at 1 rand. In other words, there was a bid offer price of 1 rand and 2 rand. We cross that spread. We buy it at 2 rand. Immediately, the value of that portfolio is half, because we can only sell it for 1 rand. So we need that buyer, that equity, to double in value before we can now get to a situation where we can say, well, now we're at break even. So in essence, if we cross that spread, we give that spread away. And if we cross it on the buy side and again on the sell side, we give it away twice. And I know particularly I started my trading career in warrants, and you would find a cheap warrant where there would be buyers at 8 cents and sellers at 9 cents. So if I went into the market and bought at 9 cents, I needed that 8 cent buyer to move to 9. I needed a 12.5% move in order for me to get to a break-even point. And that you're giving that money away. That's massive risk. So some examples are, but yeah, you know, a bid of 1 cent is 100, an offer at 110. That's 10% you're giving away. A bid of 10 cents versus 11 cents, that's 10% you're giving away still. And then an example, and I grabbed this from Anglo today, buyers at 286.20 versus sellers at 286.45. As a percentage, that comes in at about 0.1%. In essence, almost negligible. You're never going to completely get rid of that spread. You're going to have to manage that process. But we need to look at it and we need to say, you know, where does it work? And the biggest trick where this comes in, obviously, is penny stocks. But I want to drill in so we'll get to that. I mean, how do we manage the process? What are some solutions there? Well, simply don't cross the spread. In other words, in the example I had there where there was a seller at 110 cents and a buyer at 100 cents, put your buy price in at 101. Let someone cross the spread and come to you rather than you cross the spread and come to them. In other words, trade with a limit price. Say, I want to trade at this price and I won't pay any more. The risk, of course, in that example is you put your buy in at 110 and the market runs away from you. Now, that's going to very much depend on what is your trading style. How do you trade and how do you put it together? When I'm trading all the futures, I simply don't have time for it to do that for me because it potentially is moving very, very fast. If you're trading a stock like Anglo, you can absolutely put a position in and wait for the market to come to you. There's still risk that the market will run away from you. In truth, with Anglo, I would cross the spread because it's, you know, as I said, 0.1%. It's absolutely tiny. So it's pros and cons to crossing that spread. And the way I solve it, in the simplest, is I trade products that have spreads that are suitably insignificant so that when I cross them, it's not an issue. Aussie futures, you know, I used to trade top 40 stocks. I don't trade stocks anymore. But where the spread is completely of not an issue. In the Aussie futures case, that spread typically 5 or 10 points. Now I'm going to do a trade. I can make a couple of 100 points. That 5 or 10 is still giving money away, but it's not the end of the world. I would prefer not to, but in the case of Aussie futures, it often moves too fast. So we can also manage it by only trade with tight spreads. And the biggest issue there really is stay away from penny stocks. Now, what's a penny stock? Yeah, in a clear definition, anything trading below 1 rand. In truth, I'm going to say to you here, how wide is that percentage spread? And even a penny stock, a 1 rand stock with a 1 cent spread, you give away a cent on the in, you give away a cent on the out, that's 2% of your potential profits that have disappeared, as opposed to going and trading Anglo, where your spread is 0.1%, so your entry and your exit has cost you 0.2% instead of costing you 2%. And that extra 1.8%, bottom line, it goes into your pocket. And that's the whole point. We can look at a wider spread and say, well, that's what we have to pay. That's what it is. There's nothing much we can do about it. I disagree. What we can do about it is walk away and say, you know what, we won't trade that particular product because of that spread. And it might not be a product. It might potentially be a certain stock. You say, we like it. We'd love to trade it. We're getting buy signals. But you know what? This is eating our profits. So let's move away. And that's why I say to folks in many cases, you know what? You want to trade equities? Go find the 5 most liquid shares on the JSE. And with those with the biggest amount of volume going through and trade those. And forget everything else. Go trade Anglo. Go trade Sasol. Go trade Standard Bank. Go trade MTN. You know, those are the shares that do hundreds of millions of rands per day and typically have spreads that are going to be around that 0.1, 0.2%. The next is slippage. Slippage is sometimes there, sometimes not. That's when the price you see is not the price you pay. And what I mean by that, so you see a seller at 110 cents and you put your buy price in and you say, cool, trade me, and you do an at market. In other words, you don't put a limit in the price. And what happens is you end up trading it instead of 110, you trade it 111, 112. Now this is typically going to happen in your faster moving stocks. If there's a stock that's low liquid, it's probably not going to be an issue. 3 reasons largely for it. You've got a slow system. And what I mean by that is that, you know, the time from when you click do the trade until it actually gets to the market is measured in minutes rather than seconds, or measured in tens or twenties of seconds. And that depends what you're trading. If you're trading Aussie futures, you want that order to be in the market in a second. If you're trading Anglo, well, you know, 2 or 3 seconds isn't a problem. If you're trading a stock that only trades 3 or 4 times a day, a minute or two might not be a problem. The problem with that stock trading only 3 or 4 times a day is that, quite frankly, you're going to have a wide spread. So you might not have the slippage problem, but now you've got the spread problem. Slow to respond. This is particularly true in things like Aussie futures and the like. And what I mean by that is that you get the trigger. You get the signal, but you, for want of a better word, you dither. You're not sure what to do. You worry, you panic, your fears are hitting you, the fear of being wrong, the fear of losing money. And by the time you actually click the buy button, it's moved on by X amount, and suddenly you're getting in at a much more expensive level. And that's why I say you need to trust your trading systems, so that when you get that buy or that sell signal, your immediate response is to act on it and respond, and not to start to worry and the like. You need to do the right thing at the right time, and you need to do it immediately. And then, of course, there's always risk price moving too fast. And that can happen to the upside, particularly if you're trading breaks and the like, but certainly can happen to the downside when things are going horribly wrong. And something happens, a bad announcement from the company or data that comes out, and suddenly the index or the equity you're trading is, in essence, doing a mini collapse on the point, and the price is just moving massively fast. Now, particularly if I'm at stop loss, I might get slippage of stop loss, and I've had slippage as much as 200 points on the Aussie, only once, but trust me, it hurt. The point being was I still exited the position. So slippage is one of those weird things. When you're trading the less good stocks, those penny stocks, which I said stay away from, often slippage is less of an issue. When you're trading the big guys, the Anglos and the like, you might get slippage, but that slippage is going to be an absolute fraction. So you need to say, to my mind, trade the big guys, and you get some slippage measured in fractions of a percent, not an issue. So how do we deal with it? You can trade at limit price. In other words, say, buy me this but not more. For example, on a small stock, there's a seller at 1 rand 10, you put a limit in to buy 1.10. No more, no less. If he disappears or she disappears before you get there, it's not a problem because you've put your limit in. Know when to trade. In other words, act immediately. Know when you get that signal. When I'm trading Aussie futures, I trade at the end of a 15-minute candle. So if I think I'm going to get a signal to trade it at 14 minutes into that candle, i.e. a minute before I get confirmation, I set up everything. I get my buy screen ready, everything. All I have to do is click the submit button. So everything's ready, everything's in place. As soon as it confirms, I hit it. And then again, high liquid instruments, when they're moving fast, you're not going to be avoid slippage, and that's either running away from you or crashing away from you. When they're moving fast, you're not going to manage it, but certainly, as a rule, your slippage will be a lot better. And then, of course, market makers. Market makers on your ETFs, your ETNs, exchange-traded funds and exchange-traded notes, market makers in single-stock futures and commodity futures. If you're trading the Aussie Mini, the Aussie, there'll be a market maker. Warrants, share installments. Discover, work out who the market maker is, and you can typically see them. And if you watch a price over a period of time, you'll learn to see who the market maker is, and then make sure you trade with the market maker and put a price, a limit price, at that market maker price. In other words, don't move past the market maker, because they're there at fair value. If a market maker is selling at 112 cents, that's because that's what the fair value is. You certainly don't want to be paying 113, because in essence you're overpaying, you're paying more than that fair value in the process. And then the third one is costs. Now, we have to pay costs. There is absolutely no way we can avoid eating them. Point is, costs eat your profits. And the thing is, what we're doing is we're giving money to our stockbroker. Whether you make money or lose money, your stockbroker is making money in your trade. And we need to limit those costs. We need to make them as small as possible. Now, certainly in the South African environment, we've seen costs decreasing at a rapid rate. I did my first trade back in the late 80s, and your brokerage was sitting at around 2.2%, if I recall correctly. Your what is now STT, Certified Securities Tax, back then was now 0.25%. Back then it was 1%. So your costs are significantly better, but they're still not insignificant. And again, what are we looking at? It's a case of know the total cost, truly understand them. What you'll find, for example, with many CFDs, there's a percentage on the underlying, 0.35% as example, plus a 50 Rand plus VAT, so 57 Rand on top of that. So again, interrogate, know your product, know what the costs are, and find those cheap instruments. Find the cheapest place to trade them. If you want to trade warrants, it's real simple. You have to trade them at standard online share trading. Because in a warrants account, you pay 50 Rand brokerage flat, regardless of trade size. All inclusive. You're not going to find a cheaper transaction in a warrant anywhere out there. If you're trading Aussie futures, you're going to pay about 15 Rand per contract. And there's a couple of places where you can pay that 15 Rand. Some of them are 10 Rand plus VAT plus booking fees. Some are 12.50 plus VAT. Some are 15 all inclusive. Whatever the case is, you're paying around the 15 Rand. If you're paying 30 or 40 Rand, either phone your broker up and say, you know what, guy, you got to make a better price here, or change brokers to the folks who are charging you around the 15 Rand. So, you know, do that digging, do your homework, find out where are the cheap places where you can trade exactly the same product, but potentially at a cheaper price. And again, it comes back to, you know, you think to yourself, but it's only, I don't know, say it's 50 Rand per trade. Okay, and you do 100 trades a year, which is a lot, but nonetheless, you do 100 trades a year, that's 5,000 Rand. 5,000 Rand that you've given away, which you needn't have given away. Of course, the trick with changing brokers, notwithstanding there's a whole lot of paperwork up front, is make sure that you're moving to an equal platform, that you're not moving backwards, that you're not giving up functionality for the process. But in this day and age, there's a huge amount of competition out there amongst stockbrokers and the like, so really you should be able to find a stockbroker at a better price. And as I said, if it's Aussie futures, you want to pay around 15 Rand per contract. If it's warrants, trade the standard online share trading. If you're trading CFDs, there's guys out there who are offering 0.2. You can worry about a counterparty risk. That's a different debate entirely. But further to that, there's certainly a bunch of folks who are around the 0.3, 0.35, but then they have that fee on top. And what is that fee on top? Single stock futures, it's about 0.4. Some of them I've seen big houses at 0.3. Those little numbers make that difference. And then, of course, if you're trading derivative products, single stock futures, warrants, CFDs and the like, share installments, there's interest. You're paying for that derivative. So the longer you hold it, the more it costs you. So, you know, do you want to take a derivative position for 6 or 7 or 8 months? Well, if it's made you an absolute truckload of money, okay, fair enough. But if it's been a borderline trade, no. So typically with your derivative products, you want shorter trades. You want trades that are running days, maybe weeks, maybe a month or two. And I'll be honest, I've done a CFD trade that ran for 3 months. It was on the index last year. The index kept on going up. But for me, that was a long trade. And I made X amount, and I forget the exact numbers. But it was literally a case of 30% of my profit went on the interest. So say I made 10,000 Rand, well, the broker took 3, I ended up with 7. Sure, 7,000, great, made money, but imagine if it was a losing trade. And ensure that that Rand amount equals economics of scale. And what I mean by this is that if your stockbroker is charging you a certain fee, where does economics of scale kick in? And I'm going to use a Standard Bank example there because having worked there, I know the numbers. If you're trading a straight equity, 10,000 Rand, you pay 0.96%. And there above, you pay the 0.96%, all-inclusive, on the sell side, 0.71. But if you do a 5,000 Rand transaction, you're paying around 1.8. If you do a 1,000 Rand transaction, you're paying around 7%, because they've got a minimum 50 Rand brokerage fee. So work out what those minimums are, work out where those economics of scale kick in, and make sure that you're trading at or above those levels, not below those levels. If you're trading below the levels, you're paying too high in terms of fees. You want to get that number, again, absolutely as small as possible. So quick recap, the three of them, spread, difference between the buy and the ask, the slippage, the price that you think you're going to pay, but you end up paying a higher price because the stock or the equity or whatever it is particularly moving. And then, of course, the good old-fashioned brokerage costs. None of them can be completely avoided. We can try and manage them. As I said, you can manage a spread by doing limit orders. You can manage slippage by trading much more liquid and trading out of fast-moving. You can manage costs by shopping around in the process. And on that point, you can also manage it by phoning up your broker. I've never had a broker who wouldn't entertain potentially managing my fees. They didn't always reduce them. But I have no problem phoning up a stockbroker, and I don't send an email. It's too easy to ignore or to decline. Phone them up and say, this is what I'm paying. Can you do me a better rate? And what they'll often do is, if they can't, they'll tell you what they need you to do in order for you to get that better rate. They'll say, well, if you were doing X, then you can have the better rate. And then you know at what point you can phone them up. But it's a humongously competitive field out there. Stockbrokers are very, very keen for business, and really they need clients. And if they might make a little bit less of you, but if that means that you're more likely to be successful and more likely to stay a client, they're probably prepared to take a small drop in how much they make every time. So know all the true costs. And as I said, that was the point of this evening's presentation. I have no doubt that everyone in the webinar this evening is very aware of spread, slippage, and costs. What I'm really trying to get here is to focus down on those minute details. If it's making you an extra 1% per trade and you do just 25 trades in a year, that's 25%. That is significant. Heck, if you do 10 trades in a year, that's an extra 10%. So, you know, we're always looking to sculpt a little bit more here, a little bit more there. As I said, just save 0.5% on the buy side, 0.5% on the sell side, 1% a trade, 10 trades a year, that's 10%. 100 trades a year, that's another 100%. It is absolutely significant. The point being is we tend to think, not much we can do about them. They're small, they're tiny. They're not. And it comes to the point I made, we need to design our systems to meet our requirements. But further to that, we need to design our systems for maximum efficiency. And part of those efficiencies need to be these three silent killers, which are that the spread, the slippage, and the costs involved. Get them as small as possible, manage them down, and it's a continually ongoing process. We don't do it today and forget about it. Every 6 months when I evaluate my trading and my trading systems and how I'm doing, one of the things as I do is look at all of these three. And the question it's almost certainly going to get asked, people are going to say, well, what's the best in this space? It's Aussie futures. You can trade an Aussie future. You're taking R250,000 exposure at the underlying level, depending, I think today it's probably closer to R280,000. Your entry is going to cost you R15 a contract. Your spread is going to be maybe 5 or 10 points. Let's put it in the middle and call it 7 points, another R70. And your slippage, let's call it maybe 3 or 4 points. Let's be onerous and say it's going to be 4.5 points. You're suddenly sitting in a situation there where you're 7 points, 4.5 points, and 1.5 points, and you're sitting at 13 points. 13 on the in, 13 on the out, R260. If you can make a decent move there, then that number really does start to significantly manage itself down, particularly if we look at it at the value of that underlying exposure. That said, Aussie futures, high-risk product, know what you're doing, not for people who've got no experience, but my sense, and it's certainly my preferred trading product. Ladies and gents, that is the presentation. As I said, fairly simple, no rocket science without a doubt there. If you've got any questions, I will take questions. Either you pop them into the question box. As I said, I'm going to be a little slow in responding because I'm running on one screen on a slow laptop. Alternatively, if you've got a microphone attached, you can raise your hand and I will activate your audio. Simpiwe's asked, he said I mentioned counterparty risk, and he just wants me to elaborate on that. Simpiwe, CFDs are over-the-counter traded, they're not JSE traded, and what that means is that you take counterparty risk. In other words, if the broker house that you are trading at goes bust, you are quite simply out of luck. Whereas if you're trading JSE products, single stock futures, Aussies, warrants, equities, etc., if your broker goes bust or commits some sort of crime or something, the JSE will step in and protect you in that process. So counterparty risk is always a real issue and not to be lightly dismissed as something that won't happen to me. We've certainly had experiences in South Africa where it has happened twice, in fact three times that I can remember in the last decade. Susan's asking about trading top 40 stocks. She says you don't make a heck lot. Susan, yes and no. You know, I think part of the trick is if we look at a small cap, let's look at Coal of Africa as perhaps a bad example, up 16-odd% today. But again, when you take spread, slippage, and costs into it, how much money would one really have made off that Coal of Africa trade? And the other point to that, I think, very much, which is very important, is, you know, if Anglo moves 3%, that's, you know, you look at it and say, whew, not a heck of a lot. Truth of the matter, it's 3%. It's money you didn't have. And if you put a derivative product onto that, you can suddenly turn that 3% into perhaps closer to 15 or 20. So I still have no problem with it. And I say to folks, you know what, if you're going to trade, I'm going to say to you, go trade the big guys. Go trade the highly liquid ones. Luke is asking, total cost component for CFDs. Luke Shaw. Broadly there, notwithstanding your spread and slippage, your cost of CFDs is you're going to usually be charged a percentage of the underlying asset. So let's say you trade 100,000 Rand of Anglo shares. Your margin requirement would maybe be 15,000. So that's how much money you need in your account. But your cost of transaction is going to be a percentage on that 100,000. Now, I've seen rates from 0.2% all the way up to 0.6%. So you pay a percentage based on that underlying total value when you buy and again when you sell, which is, so if you buy at 100,000 and you sell at 150, you get hit a slightly more on the exit side. Some brokers will also then charge you a fee per transaction, 50 Rand or 100 Rand plus VAT. That's on top of that 0.2 or 0.3 or 0.6%. And then you pay interest. Because what you did was you took 100,000 Rand exposure, but you only paid a 15,000 Rand margin. Now, your counterparty, your stockbroker, actually went and bought the 100,000 Rand shares. They've essentially lent you 85,000 Rand. So they charge you interest every day on that 85,000 Rand. And that includes weekends and public holidays, et cetera, as well. So there are three components. There's the fee on the underlying asset, typically around 0.2 to 0.6%. There's a flat fee on top of the trade. Not everyone charges it, but certainly it's fairly consistent that it is being charged. And then you pay that daily interest. Of course, if you are short, you receive daily interest. So you can do some offset there. Susan's asking, okay, so from the top 40, what shares would I suggest looking at? Well, Susan, for me, it's going to be Anglo or Billiton, because you don't want to trade both. You want them to be different to each other. Probably MTN would be my next one as a great high liquid stock. I would pick one of the banks, and I would probably pick First Rand or Standard Bank, because they're typically the more liquid in that space. I would look at SAB Miller. Certainly SAB Miller has a good amount of transaction going through. In the olden days, Telkom used to be quite good, but I would say let's drop Telkom because we're sitting with MTN. So that's given us three. Probably have a look at ShopRite. So we've got Anglo or Billiton, MTN, First Rand or Standard Bank, SAB Miller and ShopRite. Now, I'm pulling these out of my head, so go check the numbers, but certainly from memory, they were efficient, they were tight spreads, and there was a lot of liquidity going through them. So they met all the requirements. Whether you want to trade them at underlying or whether you want to trade them at a derivative position, certainly you can look at it, and that's going to depend on your risk profile. But those are the ones that I would say is a good place to start to list. What are the typical daily liquidity levels for trading? Luke, I like, you know, for stocks and the like, I like, ideal for me, 50 to 100 million going through any one day really for me works great. And that means I can get in and out nice and easy. Bigger is better. Below 100 million, I need a compelling reason. Below 50 million, I'm just not interested. So certainly north of 100 million is for me the ideal. And those stocks I've mentioned there are all doing, on average, lots of volume. And certainly, I mean, they do half a billion, sometimes a billion Rand in a day. Ladies and gents, we'll leave it there. Again, apologies for the slight delay with the technical problems. I hope the audio came through. This is not my preferred system. I've got less good quality microphones and the like, but at least we have a backup system, so we're able to run it, and my primary system is still dead. Ladies and gents, thanks so much for attending. I hope you took something away from it. Cheers.